so far, but I found heaven as love swept low. My heart beating, my soul breathing. I found my life when I laid it down. What would it fall in? Spirit soaring. I touched the sky when my knees hit the
All right, let's take a seat. How are you guys doing? Awesome. You guys are a good looking bunch of people. All right, first thing we got to do before we start is everybody take out your phones. We're going to be in the 21st century today. Today is the only day in church that you're allowed to use your phones. So take your phones out. Step one, you got to text somebody right now to tell them to join live and watch this forum. So text one of your friends, text two if you have two friends. I highly doubt it, but try it. Generationfortruth.com, there's a live link, and they'll be able to watch this live. So do it right now. I'll give you 30 seconds. All right, time's up. Next, I'd like to invite all the pastors up here. So pastors, please come on up. We'd like to, let's give a round of applause to all the pastors. Did somebody just boo somebody? Hey. Come on, another round of applause for our awesome pastors. Have you guys been blessed this conference or what? I have been so blessed by the men of God that have been just imparting the revelations. It's been awesome. I just want to introduce the pastors. We have Pastor Slavik, our youth pastor for Church of Truth. Pastor Roman. Our English pastor for Church of Truth, Pastor Jerry, a pastor from Church of Truth as well, Longview, Washington. Maybe I should skip Vlad just to say Pastor Leo, also from Church of Truth. And then we have Pastor Vlad Savchuk from Hungry Generation Church, Pastor Sergey, also from the Church of Truth, and Pastor Dima Strok from Church of the Living God. We got some fans, all right. All right, awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, who knows why you guys are even here? Anybody know where you're at? Church, nice, that's close. Awesome, it is definitely church, and the reason we're doing this thing is we see that it's important. We called it, I don't know if there's a slide, but we called it Modern Christian, a Modern World. And the reality is the world is changing so fast. You know, 100 years ago, we invented the zipper. And now we have 3D printing, we have people going to the moon. I mean, the evolution of technology has been unreal, as is with everything else. You know, once you needed to write a letter and send it by snail mail to deliver any kind of news. Today, I can see the diet and eating patterns of my friends just by following them on Instagram. It takes less than a minute to prepare a whole meal. It takes less than 24 hours to do a trip all around the globe. The world we live in is evolving at an astronomical rate, like never before. And Paul writes, you know, not only is it evolving, it's also very evident that we're living in the last days. The prophecies of the Bible have been fulfilling and are being fulfilled even as we speak. Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3, "You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times, for people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasures rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly." And unfortunately, we see that. Unfortunately, we see that reality. You know, I just want to share a few statistics with you guys. Studies show that in 2003, only 3% of the population, 25 years old and younger, in America waited to have a sexual relationship until after marriage. That same study was done in the religious group, and the number only grew to 20%. In 2012, 87.6% of people ages 18 years and older reported that they drank alcohol at some point in their lifetime. 71% reported that they drank in the past year, and 56.3% reported that they drank in the past month. More than half the people you see are casual drinkers or consistent drinkers, in fact. 2011, approximately 1.06 million babies were aborted in the US alone. That is almost twice the population of the city of Portland. In 1 year, 37% of the people that committed the abortion counted themselves Protestant. 28% counted themselves Catholic. So when we're talking about the world creeping in, it's happening. And lines are being washed away and becoming so gray. And that is really the reason we did this. That's the reason we wanted to do a forum and really discuss some of these questions. Things that were not even brought up in Christianity just a few years ago are now hot topics of discussion on a daily basis. Listen, homosexuality was shameful to be talked about even in the secular world just a few years ago. And now research is being done all over the place to somehow defend its acceptance. That's the reason we asked these pastors, that's the reason we did this whole thing, is we wanna address these questions and really talk about them instead of just letting them slide by. Because whether you like it or not, at some point you'll be asked these questions, especially as a Christian. People wanna know, what do you think? People wanna know, what does the Bible think? And that's the most important thing, is what does the Bible say about it? All right? So before we start, we got to do a few things more. Once again, you have your phones out. Like I said, we're going to be technological here. I have my phone on me, and I have my Google number, so the number I'm going to give you guys is not my real number. So don't worry. After this, I'll delete it, and you guys can't text me anymore. But show that up. That number on the bottom is my Google number, so feel free to text at any point a question that you'd like asked. I do not promise that I'm going to ask every question you text. Somebody already texted me. Nice. I do not promise that I'm going to ask every single question you guys send me, but I will be writing down a few questions that seem relevant to the topics and whatnot. And if while the pastors are answering and you either miss something or you'd like to question what they said, you send me these questions, and if I see them in time, I'll try to address that to the pastors. Next thing, we need you guys to text this number. So text 22333, and then the body of the text should be G4T287. What you're doing there, as soon as you text that, you will have a response that says that you're registered. And what you're registered is for a poll. We're going to have three questions where we're going to light them up. I will ask them of the pastors, but I'll also ask you guys to vote in what you guys think. It's going to be very simple. You'll figure it out, but please register right now so that when the poll questions come up, you'll be able to participate. Everybody texting?
Yep. Yeah, one
second. I hear the phones are on silent because I don't hear the iPhone. Awesome. Let's keep them on silent, please. Am I missing anything? I think we're good. Everybody ready?
Yeah.
All right. So the way this is going to work, it's going to be more of a discussion. It's not necessarily a question and answer. The pastors are going to be not only answering to you guys, but they'll also talk among themselves. I hope you guys enjoy this, and I hope this turns out to be a blessing for all of us. All right? I'd like to ask the first question that I had prepared here is the question of, can you be a Christian without attending or participating in a local church? And the question is, Vlad, could you enlighten us what you...
Well, if there is no local church in your area, and then that's a different question. But if there is a local church and you're a Christian and you're not going to a church, that question comes from the understanding that we have in our society today that simply says that I love God, I just don't like the church. And we must understand that Jesus, from the beginning, He is the one that built the church. He is the one that died for the church. And He is the one that said that the church is actually His body. So, no, you can't love the head and hate the body. It's kind of very difficult to do that. And we see that in the Bible when our Lord Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 25 that He said that I was in jail and you didn't visit me. I was sick and you didn't pay attention to me. I was hungry, you didn't feed me. I was thirsty, you didn't give me to drink. And they said, when did you ever have that going on with you? And Jesus said, whatever you did to the least one, you did it to me. We see same thing with Apostle Paul, who had this idea that I'm serving God while he was hurting Christians. And when Jesus met him, Jesus asked him the question. He said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? And the issue is that Jesus was in heaven already some years now. But Jesus was indicating to Paul is the way you are treating the Christian, the way you are treating the church is actually the way you are treating me. And so we must understand as believers that you cannot be a Christian follower of Jesus who does not belong to the body, because as a church, yes, we are a people. A church is not a building. Church is people, and no one is an island. I think somebody said that I really liked, he said, a Christian who does not go to church, it's like a student who doesn't go to school, a soldier who does not join an army, a citizen who does not vote, a salesman who has no customers, an explorer with no base camp, a seaman on a ship without a crew, a businessman on a deserted island, an author without readers, a parent without a family, a football player without a team, a scientist who doesn't share his findings, a bee without a hive. So we are a family as a church, and we are a body. The problem, I think, is not that we don't have people who don't go to church but believe in God. Almost every person that you meet who believes in God and who follows Jesus, who claims to follow Jesus, who doesn't go to church, usually goes to church, and I call them CEO Christians. Christmas, Easter only. And they go to church three times in their life, when they are hatched, matched, and dispatched. When they're born, parents bring them so that the priest can sprinkle water. When they are married, there is a pastor or a minister who prays for them. And also when they're dead, they no longer come to church, somebody brings them in a coffin so that the pastor can say some kind words about them. So people do go to church, but they're just not committed to it and consistently not involved in it. Think about it, if you're one of those people who don't go to church consistently, think about what would happen if your heart would beat with the same consistency as your church attendance. You'd be dead.
Yep.
Simple. If your clock would tick the same way, if your car would only drive on as many cylinders as it feels and stuff, it just won't work. And so in the same way for us, going to a church, being a church, and our relationship with God, they depend on one another, and so on. We must understand that.
Thank you. It's actually, I got quite a few questions here texted to me. Next question, we're gonna do a poll question, but before we answer the poll question, I'd like you guys to vote. So let's light up our first poll question. And I got that actually quite a few times sent. Do you think drinking alcohol is okay for Christians? So you guys will see this question 1 second. It'll light up here. We will not answer it just yet. It's going to be the following question, but let's show it to them, the poll question, so that they know which. All right, we'll give them a minute. The next question that we will ask, though, is, let's not answer, but I'll ask it. What do you do when a leader or spiritual authority fails you or hurts you? And Pastor Lee, we'll ask you to answer this, but give us just 1 second for technical difficulty, because I want the people to vote while we're answering. There we go, guys. That's the question for alcohol. Please text your answer A, B, or C, and then when we're answering the question, we will show you guys what the crowd thinks versus what's said here. All right? You can put that away now. We'll put the poll away now, and we'll go to this next question. Pastor Leo, what do you do when a leader or spiritual authority fails you or hurts you?
What do I do?
Yes, specifically.
There's too many variables to this question, because I guess in some situation hurt can be justified. Paul wrote to Timothy saying, rebuke, exhort, insist, in season and out of season. Well, people don't take rebuke lightly, so sometimes they hurt not because of the failure of the leader, but because it's just hard to swallow the truth. So, but to avoid hurt, because I believe healthy believer shouldn't be hurting at all. You know, so to be preventive, I guess, to be preventive, what we need to make sure of that we do not lean on leaders of the church with all that we have. Numerous times in the Bible we read that it's better to trust in God than in rulers, right? So oftentimes people feel disappointed because they lean on man, they idolize man, they elevated him almost to the point of being God, and they lean on him, and if he moves, they fall. So Jerry and I, we work closely. He's my buddy. Mm-hmm. And I want him to be my bodyguard also, but he's my buddy. Yeah, my philosophy is this: I'll do everything in my capacity not to fail anybody. But at the same time, I want them to have mentality that I am just a man. You know, lean on me, but not with all that you have. So if, let's say, look, we people are... we are contingent beings. We depend on very many things. I can have good intent not to fall, period, but, you know, I'm only a guy. I depend on family factors, on health factors, on tired and weary kind of factors. So here or there, I can fail somebody, and this is when I need grace. So Paul wrote, were you going to say
something? So you're saying... Is it a shift of focus then, not to focus on the leader?
Well, I guess to give allowance. And I guess I will say a few more things to cover. I'll try to cover it all. But I really like attitude of Paul when he wrote to Timothy saying, at my first defense, everyone left me. Mm-hmm. So defense means he was under attack. And everybody, his close friends left me. And then he said, may God not hold this against them. So his heart was free. But then he said, God showed up and he stood by my side. So you see Paul in this situation and he's not hurt. Seems like some people fail him, but he's not hurting. And I like Paul being that way because his trust was in God. So I have great friends, but I make allowance that they're only contingent beings. They like God, who's self-sufficient and never fails. Yeah. So I guess number one thing, be preventive. Don't put too much trust in men. Number two, if let's say you have fallen, it means you yourself need some repentance because you lean on men with too much of your weight.
How would you recommend a person find that forgiveness? You know, maybe they are hurt right now. What are the steps that they should take?
That would be a question of reconciliation between two. So let's deal with the first one first, because we have to be or appear clear of or free of hurt or offense before God. So of course, if let's say somebody dropped you and you're hurting, forgiveness must take place and repentance. Because when people blaming somebody for their spiritual state, usually it's pretty good indicator that they are still down. Because when you get up, you don't blame anybody anymore. You know, and also I think self-examination is a good thing because maybe there is a reason for hurt. Again, it's all have to do with the nature of hurt. If a leader just fail you because, let's say, leader committed some sort of sin, or maybe he was too rough or abrupt addressing some issue in your life. So we do need to have self-examination as well. Maybe we are... We just deserve that approach. Maybe we need it. So
I wanted to add a little bit to the first two questions because they kind of a little bit connected, because when people are offended or hurt because of somebody else's failure, as a result, a lot of times they leave the church and they stop believing in the church, like Pastor Vlad shared earlier. But then there's this idea of online church, universal church, where people are not planted. And I just wanted to add to the answer and say that iron sharpens iron. And so does, so do we in our relationships. So we need the church to become better people, but we also need the church to grow. And I believe that we are to be planted in the local church, that we are to be accountable, and stick through the process of growth. You know, when you're pruned, it might hurt, you might be offended, you might not like the style, and maybe the pastor that said what he needed to say didn't say it perfectly. And I know sometimes we have this demand for perfection. We have that demand for others, but we never take that same judgment upon ourselves. We give ourselves so much room to do all kinds of garbage, but you know, the leader has to be so perfect, he even supposed to know what I'm thinking. And you can hear that in your own offense sometimes, and you're like, well, he was supposed to come up and say this to me because he knew that I was going through a hard time.
And we're not saying that leaders are perfect.
Right.
We're not saying this. What we're saying, there is no reason for one to feel hurt or failed. And even if you were, you know, your health is what, spiritual health is what's important. Let the offense go.
Right.
And then there will be issue of reconciliation with leader, of course.
And you know, just to add to that, I think accountability is like a shield. You know, we're protected when we walk in the light, when we have those kind of relationships where someone is able to ask me direct questions. You know, where I'm accountable to somebody, somebody's able to speak into my life, somebody's so close to me that is able to notice when something's off. Because I can't just be floating like an independent bubble. Mm-hmm. I have to be in the body. If I'm sick, if I have a virus, what does the body do? It turns on and it begins to fight altogether against that thing that is right now coming against this pinky, which I am in the body right now. You know, and so it's the way life works. And so I really believe that. And sometimes there's occasions where leaders commit sin or leaders fail. And maybe that was more of the question. When the leader commits a sin, how do you go through the process? And let's say you were a follower of that leader who completely failed. And that I think that was kind of the direction.
Well, we're going to be out of time on this one, but thank you for that. Thank you for that answer. The next question is Roman towards you, and let's look what the crowd says about alcohol. Let's put up the response. I want to clarify here, a lot of people are texting me B's and C's and A's. Text the number that was shown on here. Don't text me that answer. Text me just actual questions, not just B's, C's. But is it okay for Christians to drink alcohol? It looks like the majority say it's not okay. Some say it is okay, and some just don't know. Roman, can you share what you have on that?
Yes. I'm trying to find my notes.
And while Roman's preparing that, let's show up the next poll question. It is going to be, the next poll question is, can a Christian have a tattoo, or is it a sin for a Christian to have a tattoo? Same thing, we're going to show up on the poll. You guys can start answering that one while Roman answers the question about alcohol.
So first of all, I'll start with just a personal testimony and go into a few scriptures. For me personally, I have left that question a long time ago. You know, I'm not interested in things that can harm my life, in things that can hinder me from, you know, walking in excellence and being a good steward of what God's entrusted in me. And I believe that that's the issue sometimes, and I've said this in the morning, that many times we try to come as close as we can to the line of what's right and wrong, and we stay on that border, and to me, that's immaturity. I think there's enough reasons for me to restrain from alcohol or you know, not consume alcohol in my life, and so personally, I buried that question long ago, just like I did with many other immature things that I dealt with when I just got saved, and it's not a question that rises up to me. Personally, I know that in the Bible, Jesus turned water into wine, the first miracle. And
yeah, that was another question that got sent in. Did Jesus drink wine?
I
Well, yes, he did. If you need some help. So did Timothy, so did church in Corinth, but it doesn't mean anything yet. So don't get too excited, guys, because I am with Roman on this one. So, yeah. Go ahead.
Yes, so the Timothy, like I was going to say, and so many other things. A few passages I want to read to you. Ephesians 5:17. It says, "For therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Holy Spirit." So I want to clearly draw an answer to the yes or no. It is a sin to be drunk. It is a sin to get drunk. It's against the word of God. And if you're getting drunk, it's not okay. It's a sin before God. Now, drinking and getting drunk is where the issue is. And that's where the little gray area is, where we oftentimes... And so here I see that when people have to consume alcohol, I want to ask the question, what do you find in alcohol that you can't find in the Holy Spirit? That's the first question. Why do you defend the topic of alcohol? Why do you defend the topic of drinking when, in line with that, alcohol has produced more deaths than anything else, divorces, people in car accidents, abuse, rape. This is the birth of this disease. And let me tell you, alcohol is a disease.
Yes.
Alcohol is demonic, okay? And if you flirt with these things and you trust yourself to judge yourself when you're gonna get drunk and when you're not gonna get drunk, and if it started for you with a glass at a dinner and then three glasses after work, you've reserved the right all to yourself to trust yourself how far you're gonna go with alcohol. I have the same line with, you know, being alone with girls, or, you know, I think that question's coming up later. But you know what I mean? You can't just trust yourself in those areas where you allow the enemy to begin to work in your life, and you give him a platform for that, and then you're shocked that you got wasted, got pulled over, and did a bunch of crazy stuff. So I'm gonna read to you a couple more stuff. So I would say this, it's better to be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Galatians 5:19, it says, "Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are idolatry, fornication, uncleanness, hatred, jealousness, outburst of wrath, selfish ambition, so on, so on, murders, drunkenness," right in line with that.
Roman, you have about 20 seconds.
Thank you. I'm going to skip to Proverbs 20. "Wine produces mockers. Alcohol leads to brawls. Those led astray by drink cannot be wise." You want to be stupid? Drink. Want to be wise? Withstand from alcohol.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm getting some text messages. People are saying the poll is full after 26 votes. I just had a person come up. The poll is not full. Keep texting. If you get an error message, just text it again. But we are getting your answers. Next question. Pastor Vlad Savchuk, can you be a Christian homosexual? That's the question.
Okay.
And by the way, this was texted as well.
Okay. But the Bible is very clear about the sin of homosexuality. We see that in the beginning with Sodom and Gomorrah, how when this sin was there and it brought the wrath of God. We see also how a small town that one priest came in to also practice this sin, and it brought the wrath of God. They were removed. And Apostle Paul clearly indicated in Romans chapter 1 that this is abomination before God, and actually this is wrong. And I'm not going to go in and read the scriptures. You can read book of Romans chapter 1. And so it's very clear from the scriptures that this act is a sin, and it's a disobedience or rebellion against God. And not only that, but also the very creation kind of gives us a common sense that God designed our bodies for a man to be with a woman and a woman to be with a man. And they asked Reinhard Bonnke once whether he thinks that he thinks about homosexuality, and his answer was not a PG version, but
He said, when I go to the gas station, he said, I don't put a gas nozzle into the exhaust pipe. That's what he said.
All right, that's pretty clear.
Anyway.
Pastor Leo, so did you have something to add?
The point was the fact that our bodies were designed. You don't have to go even to the Bible to see that God designed our bodies in such a way where a man to be with a woman and not like that. We have to understand that there is two types of people that are in when it comes to the topic of homosexuality. There are some who live in the act of homosexuality and who endorse it and who believe that this is the way God made them, which it goes against the common sense, the creation, and it goes against the relation of the scripture. And there's those who give their lives to Jesus and who might have sexual tendencies or struggles. And people who have struggles and people who are tempted in the area of sexuality, that's a different category of people. We have to help them, pray with them, and lead them through deliverance, many times help them and help them to overcome that. Usually, that's not the case. Usually the case is not with someone who is struggling. Usually it's with someone who is justifying it and who is convincing you that this is the way God made them. I think somebody said the whole idea of the gay agenda, how it started. In the beginning, the whole goal was to come out of the closet. The second stage was to demand the rights. The third stage was to demand that you and I recognize the rights. The stage number three is to take your rights, which is where we're at now, and there's one more stage, put you in the closet. And that's kind of what's going on. So when we're going in a battle, we're not going in a battle with homosexual people, and we don't have homophobic fears that we're somehow afraid and there's somehow, people that they have cancer. We are people who have to understand that there is this war that's going on, that eventually where they were in the closet, we will be if this war is not stopped. We love those people, we hate that sin, and we wanna help people who are struggling, but you can't help somebody who is justifying it, especially if somebody claims to be a Christian. Because if somebody claims to be a Christian and they're justifying, they say, this is the way God made me, they have one big problem here. They received Jesus as a savior, not as a Lord. And if somebody doesn't receive him as a Lord, honestly, there's really nothing you can do except pray and hope the Holy Spirit will help, because they would not acknowledge the word of God as a final authority.
Thank you. Thank you.
I want to add to what he said, because I've personally dealt with a few people that struggled in that sin. And, 80%, I think 80%, if not more, of homosexual people that practice homosexuality is a result of some kind of abuse, rape, and that's the result. Mm-hmm. And so these people really need healing. These people really need ministry. And I think we can learn how to serve them better and bring in the truth to them, but we can never come to the place to justify that sin.
Yes.
And so I think that we as a church will deal with many more cases of people that suffer with that. And as a result, a lot of times it's abuse, it's rape, and so on.
Okay, thank you. The next poll question, we're gonna answer right now the one you guys just voted, but first I'd like to show the next poll question. Is it okay for Christians to get a tattoo? So we have almost a 50-50 split for yes and no. This question, I'm sure you guys have heard of all over Instagram, Facebook, and almost every piece of media you can see. Pastor Jerry, can you share a little bit about that?
Well,
I think people that
if I wasn't amongst family, I'd almost feel racially profiled here, you know? But I guess, this is Church of Truth, and they do call in the expert witnesses. Amen? I want to give you a little bit of history about myself and before I came to know the Lord. Tattooing was my life. I just wasn't a collector of tattoos. I was also a distributor of tattoos. I owned tattoo shops in California all the way to Washington. So it was a lifestyle for me. And if any of you have ever been into a tattoo shop or seen a tattoo shop, it's a place full of darkness, you know? And that's the bottom line. And what I want to tell you is, as a non-believer making this my career, when I became a believer, this is how I made my money. And as a baby Christian, I find myself justifying what I was doing, knowing what the Word of God was telling me, and we'll get there. And I found myself in a dark, dark place as a baby Christian, covering my conviction, and it led me right back to the place of destruction. And I paid the price for it. And I got to tell you that as a believer, you know, not just giving you a background of the history of tattooing. I mean, for example, you know, when I came to know the Lord and hiding that conviction, you know, this is, and like I'm telling you, this is how I made my money. You know, how do you tell me, hey, I need the Lord, I need a Savior, but I have to give up my career? I mean, when you guys all came to know the Lord, amen, you knew you were in need of a Savior, you were in complete sin. But did you lay down your career? Did you lay down everything that you had put your trust and your faith into? This was something that I had to come to, and the Lord brought me there. You know, the Bible tells us that all things work together for good for those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. I wouldn't take any of that away, because God was in charge then and He's in charge now. Amen? And the faith that He's given me and putting me through that and allowing me to go through that, it's been an amazing thing. But surrendering my whole lifestyle, everything I trusted in, it was a hard thing to do. So you could see the struggle of justification. Is tattooing a sin, or getting a tattoo a sin? That's the question, right?
Yes.
It's not if I have a tattoo, it's
no,
a sin,
it's,
right?
It's okay. Getting a tattoo.
I wanted to clarify that. You know?
They actually, somebody just followed up, like, is it okay for a Christian to get a tattoo of his wedding ring?
Well, you know what? Let me tell you specifically what Leviticus tells us. And I think this will present another question. But if you were to ask me if it's a sin to get a tattoo, I would say definitely yes. It's not a gray area in the Bible. The Bible tells us, do not cut yourselves for the dead, or do not mark yourselves or tattoo your body, says I am the Lord. The Lord is specific. It wasn't Moses, because he didn't want his daughter to get a tattoo to say this. It was the Lord who told Moses, this is a commandment that I have. This was in the Mosaic law. So with that said, let's hear what this presents.
How about piercings? I got a few questions about, how about piercings? Are piercings okay, or?
Piercings, well, you know, as far as adorning yourself, the Bible gives it as an illustration. But I would say yes, you know, what's the motive of the heart behind it, you know? We're a temple, the Bible tells us, you know? I want to say something too, if I can, real quick. You know, in saying that the Mosaic law tells us, listen, do not get a tattoo, one would answer the question, and maybe you got a text of it, you know, well, we're not under the law, right?
I mean, I did get that question.
Yeah. We're not under the law. But let me tell you, listen, in saying that we're not bound to the law, I would say 100% we're not bound to the law. But do we have a moral obligation to the law? We do, amen. And what is the law of Christ? The law of Christ is to love your Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. So how do we, in having a moral obligation to the law, how do we know how to love God? We look to the Word of God. It's not my thoughts or any of our thoughts here. As someone said earlier, listen, the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture. That means from Genesis to Revelation, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. We don't have to come up with our own thoughts, our own ideas. We rebuke, we proof our lives according to the Word of God. And God, knowing He was the same today and forever, Pastor, He says, listen, don't get a tattoo.
Pastor Jerry, I have a question. Can you elaborate on the darkness behind tattoos? And another question said, you mentioned something about not for the dead. What do you mean by that? The Bible says, well, marking not for the dead. What is the darkness?
The history in that specifically, when he talks about that in the Levitical law, is saying that don't mark your bodies for the dead. The Canaanites, I believe history will tell us, they were the ones who specifically, when, you know, in worshiping the other God, when people died, they would cut their bodies. It was cutting their bodies in what they did. The tattoo specifically came from the resource of Egypt, I believe, if you do your history. And it was actually more pointed towards the women. The women would get tattoos for the fertility god of different things if they wanted to have a child. So wow. Moses said, you know, just like the law was great for, you know, the law was to show us our need of a Savior, but also for the Jewish people, it was for apartness, you know? It was to separate them from the world. So tattoo in all its form, in all its history, in all its origins is pagan. You know, it comes from the pagan world.
Show me one good thing that came out of it.
Yeah.
All right.
If I may, because we need to introduce our audience to new criteria here, because we're looking at things from point of view sin or not sin. When we read Apostle John, he speaks of the world. He introduces the whole new thing and saying, all that is in the world, lust of flesh, lust of eyes, and pride of life. So sometimes things that we're addressing, they don't fall immediately in thou shall not. And therefore we think, well, this is not sin. But it falls into category of the worldly things, and worldly things will ultimately lead you to sin.
So even if you're getting a tattoo of a Bible verse?
It doesn't matter. Actually, the observation that I've made, and I'm glad I saw some of the mountain people here. Maybe it'll be helpful for some of you guys, and maybe it'll be helpful for the rest. But this is what I observe, and it's almost like 100% thing. First thing that graduate does after his graduation is piercing or tattoo, it's almost guaranteed that pretty soon he's gonna fall out of fellowship. And the reason behind this is this. Why? His mind is not in the right place. It's hard for me to imagine committed, Christ-centered person thinking, what shall I adorn myself with? Mm-hmm. You know, it's all about what's cool out there, what will sell me, what will make me look good. Actually, in issues with alcohol as well, with tattoos, it's all the same. It's all come to the level of your commitment. If you're really committed, and we all ought to be, you know, there is no such thing as 50% follower of Christ. We all ought to be. Then when I'm like, okay, God, if I want to lay down my life for you now, like, well, what tattoo should I get?
Yeah, Pastor Jerry?
You know, talking to tattooing, and we could see that
we're going to do 30 more seconds on this.
You know, talking about the origin of it's pagan, just a simple reminder of Bible scriptures that we know. You know, Romans 12 tells us this, don't be conformed to the image of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know, when Paul tells us be all things to all men, he doesn't tell us for the sake of washing down the gospel. So we don't need to go out there and meet the world on their level. We need to go out there and present the gospel of hope to them and a message of hope. And
thank
we don't
you.
Have to
thank
look
you.
Like them to do so, you know. I think in asking the fullness of your question, too, and I don't know you this, I'll be a little more prophetic, if I may. Did anybody mention about Jesus having a tattoo?
Yes, they did.
Of course they did, yeah.
Yes, they did.
As I told you, I'm an expert witness in this category. I want to tell you that, if I may, that this is a very, very poor interpretation of what the scripture means. First of all, I really would ask you, if you even ask that question, that you really need to really check the motivation of your heart. Because I'll tell you this, in the book of Revelation, there's so much symbolism of what things mean. And if you read in Revelation 19, where I believe that that's at, it's telling us a description of Jesus in the return of himself, you know, coming down. And it talks about that, listen, he'll be in a robe dipped in blood, right? And but yet this robe is completely white. So these are symbolic. I mean, he says that he'll have eyes of fire. Okay, and his tongue will be like a sword. And it said, written upon his robe and his thigh, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But what I see in that scripture, and if you really read it truly, it's talking about, and you know the history of it, it's talking about on their robe. A lot of kings in this time would characteristically write things about themselves that meant things about themselves. And what it's saying is it's meeting us and showing us symbolically who our Lord and Savior is. It's not meaning that on his thigh. It's in the robe or a stash covering the area of his thigh. Because if he came down, you could see his thigh. I think you could read also in the Bible that, you know, he would be naked at that point.
Yes.
And another thing I want to point out just real quick is that, listen, Jesus, he didn't come here to break the law. Yes. He came here to fulfill the law. He was bound to the Mosaic law. So Jesus in his return is not going to come with a tattoo. You know, it's ridiculous.
All right.
And so real quick, I just want to tell you, listen, if you want to use Jesus as an example to justify your liberties or whatever they are, if this isn't a liberty or your sin, listen, Jesus went to the cross and he carried his cross daily. And ask yourselves, are you carrying your cross? Jesus was the perfect example of surrender and he laid down his life to a hurting world. If you want to fight for your rights to be more like Jesus, then pick up those rights. Amen?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, before we go to the next question, let's put up the next poll question. I got actually quite a few that sent in, but about music. And the poll question is, all secular music bad? We'd like to see your guys' opinion first, and then we're going to also answer this question a little bit. So text to 22333, text your answer, A, B, or C. Is all secular music bad? So we're going to return to that question. But in the meantime, while you guys are voting, I want to ask about abortion. Pastor Leo, is abortion always wrong? Can you enlighten, is abortion always wrong?
Let me, because again, there could be so many variables to every case, you know, and sometimes what liberals want to do, they want to pick next to impossible kind of case mm-hmm. to legalize or justify something. This is what we need to ask ourselves. Does abortion always end life? And it always does. It always have to do with killing an innocent baby, and it always have to do with breaking God's commandments. So I know this rare or almost unreal cases, they almost don't exist. So I'd say abortion is always wrong. And if there is case with some variables in it, when it's very tough moral decision, you know, let's say pregnant mother went through accident and both her lives in danger, she needs to make a choice. God forbid that anyone will get there. It'll be very tough choice to make, very tough call to make, yeah. But besides that, I would say just always murder.
So even if a person's raped, still murder?
What does it change? Why do you get even with innocent baby when somebody else? If my neighbor will hurt me, I'm not going to take it off on his children, but this child is not even just somebody else's, but it's your child as well. Many find a solution in this. They give birth and give a child for adoption because they themselves cannot live with reminder in front of them of, you know, what happened to them. There's always a more noble and a better way than a murder.
Thank you. Wow.
Is there a few minutes?
Yes.
I just want to add a quick story. I was on a flight back from Africa on a long flight, and I was talking about the Lord with somebody next to me, and there was a lady behind me who goes to a really known church in Tulsa, and she was kind of listening in on conversation, and she engaged a conversation with me, and she began to share her story. And this woman, who is a faithful follower of Jesus now, in her life has committed over 10 abortions. And when she was telling me her story, she was weeping, and she said, I will never be the same. Yeah, I know God healed me. I know God forgave me. But I will never be the same after doing that. Wow. I just want to tell you that girls that have committed abortion, you have no idea how hard it is to deal with that afterwards. And she spent her whole life now helping girls that are trying to get abortion and educating girls and sharing her testimony, flying all over the world. She's like, I'm forever in debt to this generation to speak the truth about abortion.
Oh, thank you for that, Roman. Wow.
Yet at the same breath, I want to say, in back up what Roman just said, that there is forgiveness for such thing and healing, because I know when we speak to audience and we're saying blindly, like, no, this is what it is, many people raise following question. Well, what about, you know, me and my situation? There's always healing in God and forgiveness.
Thank you. Yes, yeah. That's very important. Thank you. All right. Well, Pastor Lee, I'd like to follow up. Let's show our results for the poll question about secular music. Is secular music a sin? Is secular music bad? The majority of people say yes, but I'd say Pastor Leo, can you add to that?
What is your favorite tune?
Yeah, well, you know, and to kind of broaden the scope, trance or electronic music, I had some questions about that. You know, what exactly is secular music, and is it bad? You know, how about music without words?
Yeah, again, when we raise this kind of questions, we probably expecting a straight answer from the Bible somewhat that sound like thou shall not listen to secular music. But word secular is not even in the Bible. What secular means, it means it does not mention God or religion apart from God. So if music was made just to worship God, if let's say that was original intent for music, then I would say yes, but I don't have proof for it either. I do believe Bible doesn't address everything directly, but concept is always there. And many go to the Bible to justify things that they do. They go to the Bible with an attitude, if Bible does not forbid, then Bible does permit. And this is what they want to hear. But I would suggest different approach. If Bible does not prescribe, then Bible does not permit. And in this case, I would like to take our audience to a verse in Philippians, I believe chapter 4.
Actually, somebody just texted that. Finally, really? Brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are pure.
Whoever you are, like-minded person, I love you.
I just got that response right there.
Yeah, so if, you know, I recently took my wife to an orchestra event, and we were sitting there listening to some Spoon River kind of music with tuba and flute and this, you know, and there was nothing bad about this. Of course, it's just the music. There was no lyrics, but we're dealing with lyrics and knowing that music is very influential. You know, music influenced people to commit suicide or to take innocent lives. So we need to ask ourselves if it's pure and honorable, if Jesus would sit next to you and listen to this kind of music. You know, so of course, you know, there was, even in Old Testament, we see that there's festivals and weddings and dances. And I don't think each time they did this, singing El Shaddai, but it was pure.
Yeah, okay.
So.
Johnny Cash. How many of you like Johnny Cash, right? You know, I was a big fan of Johnny Cash. I even named my son and gave him his middle name, the Cash. But Johnny Cash, he had a saying, and it was this. He said,
"You like Cash or you like Johnny Cash?"
I like them both. You know, I work for the Lord, so I don't see much of neither of them. But my rewards are not here on earth, amen? That was the point. But Johnny Cash, he had a saying, listen, I'm a Christian and I'm an artist, but I'm not a Christian artist. Or he said, I'm a Christian, I'm a singer, I'm not a Christian singer. And you know what, that really convicted me after hearing that, and I put it down, because you know what, that word Christian, it means a person for Christ.
Yes.
And again, you know, Jesus said, be holy, for I am holy. He was that greatest example. And in all our lives, no matter if we're at home, if we're at work, what we listen to, the things that come in, you know, our eyes, our ears, what they take in, it says, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You know, we collect all that info in our heart. And so, you know what, we need to be a person for Christ. It's not really a question, and a lot of these questions aren't really for, you know, can we do them? But listen, you know, what does it benefit us, you know?
Yeah.
Well, what do we gain from doing any of this? You know, well, there's a dying world out there.
Amen. Thank you, pastors. Mm-hmm. All right.
You know, I hope I'm not contradicting you, bro, by any means. With this Christian singer, not a Christian singer, but this is my personal stand, though. I do not recognize Christian music as Christian music unless they state boldly, they're boldly for Christ. You know, there's plenty of groups right now who in their pursuit of financial gain, excluding this word, so song can be sung to girl or Jesus, and it doesn't, you know. And for me, it's a weak stand, and for any devout believer, it will be. Therefore, I'm not in support of such music. You know, just say Jesus, wear it on your sleeve, man.
Thank you. Yeah. All right. Okay. Well, next question has been probably the most texted to me. And Pastor Dima, what's dangerous or wrong about being physical before marriage? And I've got a bunch of questions about, is kissing okay? Is dating okay? How far is too far? Can you just kind of expand on that? Yeah, it's a loaded question. They're coming in right now. Is dating biblical? Boom, right there. Hello?
One, two. Yeah, biblical what?
The question says, is dating biblical? Question mark. Is kissing sin before marriage? Right there, they just keep flowing in.
Okay. Whew. We have 3.5 minutes, right? Я буду по-русски.
I'll interpret, so he's going to speak Russian.
Лучше для вас будет, да. Ну, во-первых, Писание говорит, это Екклесиаста, 3 глава,
Ecclesiastes 3,
Слово Божие говорит, что все сделал Он прекрасным в свое время.
He made everything beautiful in its own time.
Да. Поэтому здесь как бы этот вопрос, он касается каких-то процессов, которые происходят в нашем сердце.
So this question deals with processes that happen in our hearts.
И захватывают также какие-то плотские или же физиологические или биологические процессы,
as well,
которые Бог вложил в нас.
That God put into us.
И поэтому Господь говорит,
and
что
so
Бог
says,
сотворил все хорошим или прекрасным
He created everything beautiful in its own time.
И вот как вопрос ставился в самом начале.
So as the question was,
is it wrong or
what's dangerous?
Or it's dangerous to be in physical relationship before marriage, mm-hmm. right?
Yep.
То есть здесь два вопроса.
So there's two questions here.
Здесь вопрос как бы юридически можно сказать.
A law type question.
Где мы можем сказать это правильно или неправильно?
Where you could say right or wrong.
И второй.
And the second question.
Это будет ли какие-то consequences?
Are there going to be consequences?
Здесь, я думаю, не или, не или. Здесь я на два вопроса могу смело сказать.
Both questions.
Они оба неправильные. То есть
they're both wrong.
Это и dangerous,
it is dangerous,
and wrong.
And it's wrong.
И самое начало, что мы можем взять, это мы берем из Бытия 2 глава.
First of all, Genesis chapter 2.
Где Господь проговорил к первым человекам. И он сказал: оставит человек отца своего и мать свою,
and it says that the man will leave his father and mother,
и прилепится к жене своей,
and he will be attached to his wife,
и будут одна плоть,
and they will be one flesh.
Здесь Бог установил какой-то принцип.
Here God made some kind of principle.
Ну, номер один, он сказал, что прилепится, кому он прилепится?
The first question is, who is he going to be attached to?
Прилепится, написано, к жене своей.
It says he'll be attached to his wife.
Not to boyfriend. Not to boyfriend to be, not to fiance, right? Not to girlfriend, but to к своей жене.
To his wife.
То есть у Бога есть принцип.
So God has a principle.
Этот вопрос очень важный. Почему? Потому что решив этот вопрос, мы решим свое будущее.
Making the decision in this question, we decide our future.
Я всегда молодым людям задаю вопрос.
I always ask young people.
Каким будущим ты, какое будущее ты для себя хочешь?
What kind of future do you want?
И все отвечают: я хочу счастливую семью.
And everybody says, I want a happy family.
Я хочу, чтобы все радость
была. I want everything to be wonderful.
Чтобы всегда муж меня любил.
I want my husband to always love me.
Жена меня любила.
For my wife to always love
me. У нас всегда было все в порядке.
For us to always have everything good.
Но вы знаете, такой дом.
But you know, this is the kind of
house. Если семью мы сравниваем с домом, строительством дома.
If we compare a family to a building of a house.
Такой дом,
the house
он должен строиться на серьезном основании.
Has to be built on a strong foundation.
И это основание.
And this foundation.
Заложено не в мнении этого мира.
It's not based after opinion of the world.
Не в мнении культуры.
It's not based off the opinion of culture.
Которая навязывается нам каждый день.
That tries to come upon us every day.
Это мнение.
This is based on.
Заложено в Боге и в Его Слове.
On God and His Word.
И мы знаем, если Бог благословляет.
And we know that if God blesses.
Стройку.
The construction.
Или же, если Бог охраняет там город,
and if God defends the city,
то тогда не напрасно бодрствуют стражи.
Then the guards are awake for a reason.
Да. И здесь мы видим принцип. Вот
we
он,
see a principle
вот
here.
Он открыт.
It's open.
Оставит человек отца своего мать.
A man will
когда
leave
человек
his
оставляет отца свою мать?
When does a person leave his parents? Somebody says, I've left them a long time ago.
Вообще это процесс, когда человек, то есть когда муж становится мужем для своей жены.
But that's when a man becomes a husband for his wife.
Приходит, когда происходит сочетание в
церкви. It's when the marriage happens in the church.
Когда происходит благословение.
When blessings happen.
И когда пастырь перед церковью.
And when a pastor before God in the church says, and now I pronounce you.
Тебя женой, husband, женой и мужем.
Husband and wife.
А перед этим отец, мать оставляют.
But prior to that, the father and mother, they have to leave them.
Сейчас мы передаем вот этому человеку.
They say, now we give my person to that
вот
person.
Вот тогда Библия говорит,
then the Bible says,
он прилепится.
Then
то есть,
he will be
тогда
attached.
Будет происходить вот эти, как сказать, прилепится, как бы быть в тесных отношениях,
so then they will
тесном,
be in
the, тесном общении.
Close relationships.
А в другом месте, 1 Коринфянам, 37 глава, 1 по 3 написано, о чем вы писали мне, хорошо человеку не касаться женщины.
It says, you wrote that, is it good for a man not to touch a woman?
Блуда, каждый имеет свою жену,
but to run away from lust, each have your own wife,
имеет своего мужа.
And each have your own husband.
Фраза не касаться значит не дотрагиваться.
The phrase
не
not to touch, so not to burn up that fire.
То, говоря о physical, мы сейчас уже вот
so
видим,
talking about
да?
the physical, we see it right here.
Да, апостол Павел говорит, хорошо не касаться.
Apostle Paul says it's good not to touch, it's good not to light that fire up.
Почему?
Why?
Потому что есть благословение,
because
которое приходит в свое время.
That comes in its due time.
Не так ли, да?
Isn't it true?
Есть, приходит свое
Doesn't
время.
It come?
И это время Божье.
And this is in God's time.
Есть, вот сейчас в этом миру бытует такое,
right
такое,
now, world,
такое выражение.
This expression.
Если очень сильно хочется,
if you really want it,
тогда можно.
Then it's okay.
Да?
Yeah?
Если очень сильно
if
хочется,
you
тогда
really
можно.
Want it, then it's okay.
Вы знаете что?
But you know,
мы возвращаемся к
we
второму
come
вопросу.
Back to the second question. Are
будут
there consequences? Will there be consequences?
Consequences будут,
there will be consequences.
Почему? Потому что
Why?
Есть такое понятие,
because
как камин, то есть как огонь в камине. Like a fire in a fireplace.
И это благословение.
And it's
a blessing.
Мы греемся,
we
мы
sit there, we enjoy the fire, it's warm.
Наслаждаемся просто этим, да?
We watch it.
И мы говорим, какое благословение.
And we say, what a blessing.
Это когда Бог благословляет.
That's when God blesses.
Секс или физические
it's when
отношения,
sex or physical relationship are inside the family.
Они не просто допустимы.
They're not just allowed.
Они необходимы.
But they're required. They're blessing.
Но когда мы берем этот огонь,
but when we take this fire and we put it into our living room and put the fire on the couch or on a chair or table or on the hardwood floor,
we have a problem. Скажите, будут ли consequences?
Will there be consequences?
Consequences будут.
There will be consequences. And so,
Слово Божье тоже говорит,
the word of God says,
может ли кто взять себе огонь в пазуху,
can a person
чтобы не прогорело платье его?
Take his fire in his hand and that his clothes would not burn.
Вопрос.
It's a rhetorical question.
Ответ уже заложен.
The answer is already there.
Не может.
You
если
can't.
Ты берешь огонь в пазуху,
if you take fire into your hands,
будет проблема.
There will be a problem.
Вы знаете, что и для нас сейчас решить этот вопрос
and
сейчас
us,
пока
to solve
еще не
this question, while it's not too late.
Почему? Потому что Библия говорит: и познайте истину,
the Bible
и истина делает вас свободными.
And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free.
Знаете, я перед Богом уже дал такое
I've
обещание.
Already made this covenant
я буду
before
сражаться,
God.
Я буду говорить эту истину.
I will say this truth.
Будет она популярна, не будет она популярна.
Whether it's
будут
popular
меня слушать,
or not.
Не будут меня слушать.
Whether people listen to
я
me or not.
Я
made a promise.
Я до смерти буду говорить,
to
что
my
это
death,
неправильно.
I will say that
я
it's
буду
wrong.
Говорить, что dating неправильно.
I will say that dating
я буду
is wrong.
Говорить, что эти отношения,
I'll say that these relationships, the hugs, kisses, all that stuff, they all lead to sin. That's just experience already. I have a certain experience already besides the proof in the Bible. We did a questionnaire amongst men, about 50 men that were married already.
And we said,
what do you think?
Хорошо ли вот иметь такие вот
отношения до свадьбы?
Пусть даже ты engaged или
maybe
not
you're
engaged.
Even engaged or not. Well,
boyfriend, girlfriend, такое, для меня это тоже понятие
народное. I don't understand that either.
Можно ли там обниматься, целоваться?
Can you hug them, kiss them?
И только два человека из 50
человек
сказали да.
Said yeah.
И это были, ну, новообращенные
and
люди, которые
two people that said yeah, they just came to God recently. They literally just came.
48 человек остались женатых мужчин, которые уже
men,
знают, что
that
это
already
такое.
Know what it is.
Они сказали: "Нет, это опасно".
They said, no, it's dangerous.
Это нехорошо.
It's not good.
Вы знаете что?
You know,
еще был такой один момент, когда одна девушка пришла ко мне, которая уже вышла
came,
замуж,
who already got married,
которая уже у нее уже дети,
who already has children,
и пришла с плачем.
And
и
she
она,
came
и
with
она
tears,
говорила мне такие слова.
And she said these words to me.
Она на меня называла father.
She called father. Me father. She said, father,
why wouldn't you just lock me in the closet when you told me that it's not the will of God? Я говорю, я тебе говорил, что это неправильно.
I said, I told you that it's wrong.
Моя ответственность сказать.
My responsibility is to tell you that it's not wrong.
But your responsibility to make that final decision, right?
So it's your.
И сейчас она плачет.
And so now she's crying.
А будут обязательно
because there's consequences, and consequences will definitely be there.
Мой брак разваливается.
And she says, man, my marriage is falling apart. Why did I not listen to you? Why did you not just lock me in that closet and not allow me to come out? I said, God can't even do that to us. God can't even do that to us. Тут вопрос к вам сразу. А вы, did you date?
С моей женой?
Yes.
What does it mean, date? Если...
Wow, a lot of them are coming
yeah,
in.
Yeah, so это если есть таких два понятия.
There's
dating,
two understandings.
Которые в мирском понимании.
Dating in the worldly sense.
Это relationship или отношения, которые несут,
dating,
не несут
do not bring
никакого посвящения.
Any kind of dedication.
Когда человек, он
when
не дал посвящение своему, когда он не принял решение,
decision,
когда его, к примеру, не объявили в церкви, когда пастор этого не знает, они начинают встречаться. Вот, это я понимаю так.
That's what, I think that's what dating is.
We didn't date.
That's the answer.
Поэтому я говорю, что...
Let's do three more minutes.
Я вижу, что те... То есть, когда мы проходим через вот эти вот, как мы говорим,
gray areas,
мы теряем силу в будущем нашем.
We lose the power in our future.
Почему? Потому что тогда
why? Because
мы идем в будущее,
then
как
we go into the future as ministers,
уже с каким-то дефектом,
with some kind of defect already,
механизм, который взорвется,
that's going to explode on us when we're in our ministry. Where the devil will keep reminding us, oh, don't you remember? Do you even have boldness to teach about purity? Do you have boldness to teach about truth of God? Do you have boldness about teaching about purity? If you did all those things, and you won't have it. So there are consequences with that.
Но я верю, что я сейчас и растет новое поколение.
But I believe a new generation is rising up that will do the right choices.
И я вижу, ну, допустим, у нас
see,
церковь,
for instance,
последние
in our church,
5-6
the last
семей,
few
которые
families,
сделали
5-6 families
по слову
that just did everything according
знаете,
to the word of God. You know,
Илья,
like Elijah that made that altar out of the stones, he did everything right. And then he had boldness to say, Lord, I did everything according to your word.
И мы можем ожидать огонь
and we can expect a fire from
и тогда
God.
Бог будет приходить
and then God will come.
И приносить, и будет приходить слава Божия в церковь.
And the glory of God will come. I think Pastor Leo wanted to add something.
Just 30 seconds, if I may, because besides choices and consequences, we need to take into consideration honoring God. And I think this is what he hit on right at the end of his speech, because our motive shouldn't be like, well, what I'm going to get or how I'm going to end up. This season is given to young people, just like any other season in our life, in Christian life, to honor God. So singleness is a season to honor God during this season, so people around you can give glory to God and say, wow, being Christian really advantageous, being Christian is really cool. So sometimes instead of honoring God and exploring each other's personalities, people are too busy exploring each other's body parts, and after they end up being married, they realize they're living with a stranger because all of this premarital time was ways that Christ was not on, honored, and now they have nothing in common anymore. So I'd say to anyone who is single yet, this is wonderful season. Put it at the feet of Christ. Honor him by this season of your life.
Mm-hmm.
And the Word of God also says, 1 Corinthians 13, love is patient.
Да, любовь долготерпит. Если это настоящая любовь, она будет терпеть.
It will be patient.
Да. И если мы бежим за Господом,
and if we run after God,
если мы имеем эту true relationship
with Christ, if we have a true relationship with Christ,
тогда мы будем иметь силу,
then we will have the power,
противостоять всем temptations,
to stand against all the temptations,
и настоящую любовь она сможет
ждать. And have the true love that will be patient.
И когда ты выйдешь на эту сцену,
and when you come out on the stage,
и пастор скажет, now I pronounce you,
and the pastor pronounces
husband and wife, It's going to be a true celebration.
Thank you. Thank you. Wonderful. We're going to move on to our next question. Thank you. Pastor Sergey, this next question, I circled it because a lot of people have been texting about war. Is it okay for Christians, Pastor Sergey, is it okay for Christians to pick up arms? Somebody said a question. Is it okay for Christians to defend themselves to death? Another question came in, is it okay for Christians to be a police officer or in law enforcement? But all seemingly around the fact is it okay for a Christian to go into the army, to be in war, to pick up arms? Of course, maybe many years ago,
Он не был такой актуален.
This question wasn't so actual as it is for us right now.
Потому что в то время христиане более радикально подходили.
Christians were a lot more radical about this.
Но так как сегодня эта тема она затрагивается.
But because this is being touched right now,
я поделюсь не только
I will share not just
своим мнением,
my opinion,
но я верю, что так говорит и Слово Божье.
But I believe that that's what the Word of God says.
С самого начала давайте мы обратимся к тому, что было в начале.
First of all, let's talk about what was in the beginning.
В начале нашей эры.
In the beginning of our era.
Я слышал такое высказывание,
когда I heard somebody say,
к Иоанну пришли воины и сказали ему, что как нам поступать, что нам делать.
When warriors came to John and said, what do we do, how do we act?
Иоанн сказал им, John чтобы said, они довольствовались своим жалованием.
For them to
и чтобы они не обижали
for them not
людей.
To hurt people, for them to be satisfied with what they have.
Как, в основу новозаветных
And now
взглядов.
People say, okay, see that, that's from the New Testament, you can do that.
Но мы должны понимать,
but we have to understand
что Иоанн был ветхозаветным пророком.
That John was an Old Testament prophet.
И на Иоанне Крестителе закончилось
because John the Baptist was
ветхозаветное служение.
The finality of the Old
Поэтому
Testament
Иисус
era.
Сказал, что
that's what Jesus said,
в царстве
the least in the kingdom
будет больше, чем Иоанн Креститель.
Should be greater than John the Baptist.
Поэтому мы не можем брать
ветхозаветный
взгляд на оружие,
about weapons,
на войны,
about war,
и вводить их в Новый Завет.
And pull that into the New Testament.
Что говорит Новый Завет?
What does the New Testament say?
Новый Завет он связан
the New Testament
с приходом Иисуса Христа.
Deals with the coming of Jesus Christ.
Иисус Христос был рожден
Jesus Christ was born
в Римской империи.
In the Roman Empire.
Римская империя
the Roman
захватила
Empire
в то время весь цивилизованный
captured at that point the whole civilized world.
Практически весь мир в то время был покорен
was conquered by the Romans.
Римлянами. В том и также была покорена и Палестина.
Including Palestine.
И были ревнители,
and there were people who
которые
were zealous,
хотели освободить
who wanted
Израиль
to free Israel
от угнетения римского.
From the persecution of the Romans.
Но мы нигде не видим
but we don't see it anywhere,
ни одного намека,
not a single hint
чтобы Иисус делал
that Jesus would emphasize
что надо освобождаться
that they have to free themselves
от римского гнета.
From the Roman burden.
Но что говорил Иисус?
But what did Jesus say?
Он подчеркнул
he emphasized
важность своего царства.
The importance of his kingdom.
Он провел конкретную границу.
He drew a line.
Кроме того,
besides the fact,
он сказал, что царство
he said
мое
that my kingdom
не от этого мира.
Is not from this world.
Другими словами,
все
последователи Христа,
every follower of Christ,
это люди не от этого мира.
Are not people from this world.
Это сразу дает ответ на те вопросы.
This answers those questions.
Какое царство мы защищаем?
What kind of kingdom are we defending?
Если я последователь Иисуса,
if I am a follower of Jesus,
то мое царство
then
my kingdom, является Иисус Христос.
Where the Lord is Jesus Christ.
Еще одно место он сказал так.
He also said in another place,
что я от вышних.
That I am from above,
а не от нижних.
And they are from below.
Вот эти нижние,
these from below,
люди этого мира,
people of this world,
они подвязаются за ценности
they
этого
attach
мира.
To the values of this world.
Вы знаете, христиане, они вне политики.
You know, Christians are not in politics.
Христиане, они вне гражданских Christians таких прав, которые существуют в этом
are
мире.
Not in the civilian rights where people participate.
Сегодня может быть одна власть, завтра может
today,
быть другая власть.
One government, tomorrow the government might change.
И каждая власть будет призывать,
every
чтобы ее защищали.
Is gonna call for free or protection.
Живя в этом мире,
living
мы должны
world,
молиться за власть,
pray about the government,
платить таксу,
pay our taxes,
быть честными людьми,
be honest people,
но мы не от этого
but
мира.
We're not from this world.
Апостол Павел очень четко подчеркнул.
Apostle Paul emphasized,
он сказал, что о горнем помышлять, а не о
think
земном.
About the heavenly and not about the earthly.
Есть высшие критерии у нас.
There are higher criteria.
Если мы помышляем о горнем,
if we think about the
то земное
heavenly,
притяжение,
then the earthly
оно теряет силу
gravity loses its force.
Иисус сказал, что так как я не от этого мира,
Jesus said, as I am not of this world,
вы тоже не от этого
you
мира.
Are not of this world either.
Меня гнали, и вас будут
I was persecuted, and you will be persecuted.
Мы чужие в этом мире.
We are foreign in this world.
Дьявол от начала пытался соединить
the beginning tried to merge the church
и мир.
And the world.
Иисус сказал,
Jesus said,
что я пришел, чтобы отделить вас. И он говорит, мир вас не примет.
He said, the world will not accept you.
Какой мир мы защищаем сегодня?
What kind of world are we defending
today?
What kind of government?
Мое государство.
My government.
Это Божье царство.
Is God's kingdom.
Мой царь Иисус
my
Христос.
King is Jesus Christ.
Я ему однажды пообещал служить.
And I've pledged my allegiance to him.
Поэтому я не беру оружие,
that's
чтобы защищать какое-то государство.
That's why I do not pick up arms to protect the government.
Я не воюю за какой-то
I do not go to war for any government.
На этой земле
on this earth,
я взял оружие Божьего
I
Слова.
Took the weapons of God's word,
и оно не плотское.
And it is not a flesh.
Оно сильное Богом.
It is powerful by God,
чтобы разрушать твердыни
to destroy
дьявола.
The principalities of the
чтобы
devil,
отвоевать души у
to
дьявола.
Fight back for the souls
чтобы
from the
приводить
devil,
их в Божье царство.
To bring people into the kingdom of
потому
God,
что мы последователи Иисуса.
Because we are followers of Jesus.
Поэтому мы не заигрываем здесь властью.
We're not playing with governments.
Мы не стараемся быть такими, чтобы им понравиться.
We're not trying to be people pleasers.
Но мы почитаем нашего царя.
But we honor our king.
Имя его Иисус Христос.
His name is Jesus Christ.
Я могу об этом много, конечно, говорить.
I can say a lot about this.
Но вы мысль уже поняли.
But you got the thought.
Поэтому я хочу обратиться к молодому поколению.
I want to talk to the young generation.
Сегодня эта граница стирается.
Today this barrier is being deleted.
Вы знаете, придет время,
you know, the time will
где
come,
больше не будет государств.
When there will be no more,
будет правление одного
no more governments.
Человека.
One man will rule.
Сегодня все политики, вся мировая система
today,
работает
all the
на этом.
Politicians, all the worldly systems are working about it, on
задайте
this.
Вопрос.
Ask the question.
На кого это все работает?
Who does all this
на человека, который объявит себя Христом.
It works for the person that's going to call himself Christ.
В наших глазах это антихрист.
But in our eyes, that's the Antichrist.
Поэтому наше
that's why
нахождение на земле
our being on this earth
это исполнить Божье предназначение.
Is to fulfill God's calling,
Его волю.
God's destiny, His will.
Как исключение я допускаю,
as an exception, I allow,
когда люди, они when, служат в полицейских органах.
People serve in police areas,
но где это не связано с оружием?
But where this does not deal with weapons,
где это не будет, чтобы какой-то подвернулся случай, чтобы
where
убить
there will
человека?
Not be an opportunity to kill somebody.
Вот мой
that's
ответ.
My answer. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Hey, while you do that, I just want to you cut me off on my question, but you gave other people a lot more time.
Yeah, sorry.
So
I apologize.
I got fired up about alcohol.
Okay, let's do this.
So give me a second. I want to conclude. My conclusion to alcohol is withstain from alcohol for the sake of others. Okay? When I said about demonic, I meant that it's a door to the demonic, where because of the influence of alcohol, people commit murder, rape, and so on and so on. And so the conclusion to me in that area or in that issue, and the answer to maybe you, is what I found in 1 Timothy, where he says, flee from anything that stimulates youthful lust. And you can put many other things under that bracket, but instead pursue righteous living. And so I think if we fuel our pursuit after God, to walk before God, to be holy before Him, the Holy Spirit will lead us to leave many more things behind, not just alcohol. So withstand from alcohol for the sake of others, so it doesn't take your zeal to serve people who have suffered an addiction of alcohol, and for them, it's bad to even smell it. You know, and I came from, you know, my dad was an alcoholic. I suffered with that disease myself, and the Lord set me free from that. And I know what I'm talking about, and I'm telling you that this will protect your life. Don't mess around with it. It's dangerous, and I'm very passionate about this subject if you want to talk to me afterwards.
30 more seconds, Roman. Easily. Thank you. No, thank you. All right, I'm going to have a little more questions from the crowd here, but we want to keep making progress. Is this going good, guys? Awesome. Awesome. Okay. Pastor Sergey, next question is once again for you. Why don't we see so many miracles, signs, and wonders? Are these really the last days? Почему мы не видим столько знамений, чудес? Действительно ли это последние дни?
Но самое важное, нам нужно понять то, что
most important thing is we have to understand
от самого начала,
that from the beginning,
когда Иисус пришел на эту землю,
when Jesus came to this earth,
то Его царство было продемонстрировано
His kingdom was demonstrated чудесами и знамениями. By signs and wonders.
И последователи Иисуса.
And followers of Jesus.
Мы знаем первая церковь.
We know that the first church in the first century.
Это сопровождалось.
It was guided by those.
Когда Иисус покидал землю, он сказал такое
слово. When Jesus left the earth, he said this word.
Он говорит, что я даю вам власть наступать на змей.
He said, I give you the power and authority to step on snakes and scorpions.
Он говорит, что будут возлагать руки на больных.
He says that they will lay the hands on the sick and they will be healed.
И на протяжении всего времени,
and during the entire time,
пока существует церковь на этой земле,
while the church exists,
до момента, пока она покинет,
until it leaves the earth,
были разные сезоны,
there were different seasons,
но чудеса и знамения,
but signs and wonders,
они не прекращались,
they never stopped.
И сейчас мы живем,
and today we live in a time,
это особенное время,
it's a special time.
Может быть, мы не видим так ярко,
maybe we don't see as bright,
как мы хотели это видеть в странах.
As we would like to see in the countries of third world countries, in South America, Asia, Africa.
Но по местам это происходит.
But it happens.
С другой стороны, я хотел бы подчеркнуть такую важную часть.
On the other hand, I'd like to emphasize.
Сегодня,
today,
как никогда,
like never before,
Бог поднимает ревность.
God is raising up zeal
в своем народе.
In His people.
Чтобы мы могли взыскать Его.
To seek Him.
Не чудеса.
Not signs.
Не знамения.
Not miracles.
Не какие-то проявления.
Not some kind of acts.
А Его.
But Him.
Потому что все от Него.
Because everything is from Him.
Им и к Нему.
By Him and for
и
Him.
И сегодня, чтобы наш фокус.
And today.
Он не сместился.
For our focus not to be shifted.
Я знаю, что сегодня церкви нужен больший уровень познания
Иисуса. I know that today the church needs a higher level of knowing Jesus.
И тогда мы в наше время,
and then in our time,
в наш сезон увидим
our
Его
due
славу,
season, we will see His glory,
проявленную и в чудесах, и в знамениях.
That is shown in signs and wonders.
Я ожидаю этого.
I expect
и я
this,
верю,
and I believe,
что не только мои дети
that
это
not
будут
just
переживать,
my children will experience
но я сам буду увидеть
but I will see it myself, these greater
которые
things,
Бог может являть.
That God is able
как
to
Он
show,
являл,
as He did show,
являть будет,
He will show,
как Он вчера, сегодня,
because He is yesterday, today, and forever the same.
Поэтому я хочу поощрить вас.
So I want to encourage you guys.
Давайте не будем мы унывать.
Let us not be disappointed.
Давайте не будем говорить, что это было в первом веке.
Let us not say, oh, that was just in the first century.
Давайте не будем говорить, что время чудес закончилось.
That time of miracles is over.
Иисус не изменился.
Jesus did not change.
Но если мы прогрессировать будем в Нем,
but if we will grow in Him,
сегодня это время,
today,
которое говорит нам,
is the time that tells
us,
seek the Lord,
и мы будем видеть эту славу,
and we will see this glory,
проявленную и в чудесах.
Shown in signs and miracles.
Не только где-то в каких-то странах.
Not just in some countries.
Но в Ванкувере,
but in Vancouver,
Сиэтле, Калифорнии,
in Seattle, California,
во всей Америке,
all of America,
в Европе,
in Europe,
и по всей земле.
And all over the world.
Я верю,
I believe,
в этот мощный дождь последнего
in this powerful
времени,
rain of the last days,
который будет излит на эту землю,
that will be poured out on this earth,
перед приходом Иисуса
before
Христа.
The coming of Jesus. Pastor, тут вопрос. There's a question. It says, why do some people get healed, but not all? Почему некоторые исцеляются, но не все?
Но вы знаете, можно на этот вопрос в какой-то степени, но постараться объяснить.
You can try to explain this question
но
somehow.
Я вам откровенно скажу.
But honestly, I'll tell you.
Я не знаю.
I don't know the answer. Спасибо. Так, следующий вопрос. Sorry. My bad. Next question. I forget where I'm at. All right, Pastor Leo, question to you. Can a person lose his salvation? A person that's saved, can he lose his salvation?
We read Bible or take Bible for what it is and some verses of the Bible for what they say on their face, without help of theologian, then yes, you know, we have scriptures which clearly state, we have one in Galatians which clearly state that one can fall away from grace. You justifying yourself by the law, you have fall away from grace, you are left without Christ. What could that mean but the loss of salvation? Or 2 Peter, when Peter wrote about dogs who return to their own vomit, and he said it would be better for them not to know Christ in the first place. So if somebody who don't know Christ not saved, these guys will undergo a stricter judgment because knowing him, they turn their back on him. And then we have scriptures in Hebrew. I mean, there's plenty of scriptural support to this, that one can lose salvation, but it always pointing to the fact that on one condition only, when person deliberately reject Christ. No height, no depth, no angels, no strength can separate us from the love of God. I'm very secure in my salvation. I am saved. I have no fears of losing it. But I also believe man does have free will. And if a man willfully will choose to turn his back on God, he will lose his salvation. But I also want to address, because this question wouldn't be raised if there wouldn't be such thing as
predestination,
you know,
Calvinism.
Yeah.
That's what, all that's being texted right now.
Well, let's talk about this. Of course, you have to give me unlimited time now.
No.
Yeah. But this is what Calvinists do. First, they declare man totally depraved, which I agree with, which means we're completely corrupt. Okay? We cannot initiate salvation on our own. Agree, this is given. But then they go a little further. They said that we're so corrupt, we can't even respond when God initiates our salvation. We can't even respond to God. Therefore, salvation of man is 100% work of God. And if this is 100% work of God, they would say, then who can destroy it if this is, you know, this is work of God? And I'm aware of 5 points of Calvinism. I can debate them all day long and show to you how scriptures are twisted and forced to say what they're not saying on their face. But Rod said, we don't have time for this. One thing, though, concerning first statement, that man is totally depraved, nothing good in him. Listen, it is clear throughout the scripture that even fallen men retain the image of God. Okay? You can find this in Genesis 6, in Genesis 9, in Corinthians, in James. You can find this very fact that we're still, even fallen men, still in the image of God. So don't tell me there's nothing good in us. You know, and there's examples. Again, we talk about, let's say, Noah was righteous man in his generation. On the result, son of a king who died, and God said because something good was found in him. So I do believe there is enough in us to respond to work of the Lord. I also believe that the choice with free will agent performed this way. When I came to propose my wife, I asked her, will you marry me? And if she would say no, she would be one who is called, but she's not chosen. So for choice to be complete, with free will agent, it have to be two yeses. When she said yes, she was called, and now she's chosen. And Bible says many are called, but few are chosen, because many willingly choose not to respond to the call of God. So, yeah.
Spurgeon, he says, let's call a meeting of the elect, the chosen, and let's elect some more. Amen? Mm-hmm. And what I want to say about that real quick in the simplicity of what, you know, it's been an argument for centuries, can you lose your salvation? And I agree with Pastor Leo. I think there's a point where man can forfeit, but to lose is a strong word. You know, David gave insight in Psalm 51 and the repentance of Bathsheba. And he said this, he said, listen, don't cast me from your presence. Don't take your Holy Spirit away from me, but return to me the joy of your salvation, of my salvation. You know, he knew what he had deserved, but he knows how good our God is. Yeah. Amen?
Yeah.
And
do God, I have 30 more seconds?
Yes, you do.
Okay, cool.
Sorry to cut you off, Pastor.
There is some texts which people consider to be difficult. This is Romans chapter 8 and 9. When you read this, when God loved Jacob and he hated Esau and things like this. And when you read this, it appears, what text appeared to say that whomever God wants, he chooses. And when people faced with this text, they're like, what do we do with this? But I think proper reading or interpretation of ninth chapter of the book of Romans should be done with considering the theme of the whole book, how throughout the whole book, Paul building case for faith. And if you're reading it, starting at chapter 3 and arriving to chapter 9, then it's clearly that what he's trying to say, whatever God chooses, he does, and he have chosen faith. You know, so if you read this book with this in your mind, you never end up where Calvinists would. So.
Thank you. All right. I'm going to do a few questions from the crowd, and then we're going to go to our last question because we're running out of time here. But a few questions from the crowd. Is speeding a sin? Specifically, it says 5 or 10 miles over.
Sometimes unto death.
I don't think so. Thank you. All right, I'm joking. We're not going to answer that question. You guys should call your local authorities about that one. All right, cards or gambling? Is gambling a sin? Playing poker, is that a sin? Anybody, this is to anybody, this is from the crowd. Gambling, is gambling a sin?
Is gambling addictive? Does yes. Gambling cause problems?
Yes.
We just address an issue with alcohol, and I think it fall into same category. So if we want to hear Roman's speech all over again, let's do it. But
you got 30 seconds, Roman.
Bible says, whomever son set free is free indeed. Well, some would say, but we do it just for change. You know, we just do it for fun. Why there should be even appearance of evil?
Thank you. I got one text message that says, Vlad should talk. Just in general. All right, let's see. Okay, I had one. Pastor, back to you. Somebody said, if somebody is intending to hurt my family, am I allowed to defend them unto death?
Если кто-то хочет ранить мою семью или причинить вред моей семье, я могу защищаться до смерти.
Давайте мы немножко этот вопрос, как бы он, во-первых, он абстрактный вопрос.
First of all, this is an abstract question.
Знаете, когда я в армии служил,
you know, when I served in the army,
вопросы часто задавали.
I was constantly asked these kind of questions.
И, в общем-то, что у КГБистов,
as KGB agents,
что у коммунистов,
as communists,
что у сегодняшних современных,
as today,
этих, как их, да, мистов,
modern истов.
Вопрос не меняется.
The question doesn't change.
Значит, мы знаем, что есть два положения.
We know that there's two positions.
Есть положение, это когда посягают на мое.
There's a position when
имение,
somebody tries to steal my values,
на мою семью,
or my possessions or my family.
Вот, за имя Иисуса Христа.
For the name of Jesus.
И мы знаем в Писании.
And we know that in scriptures.
Убивали.
They killed.
Павел сам говорит, влачил за волосы.
Paul says that he himself pulled on people's hair for that. They would rob people for that.
Была.
And what was their reaction?
Они принимали это с радостью.
They would accept it with joy.
Если
if
кто-то может привести такой пример.
Somebody wants to bring an example.
Вот. Но если это просто бандиты,
this is just robbers,
которые хотят они посягнуть на мою
that
семью,
just want to hurt my family,
вот, и причинить ущерб,
and cause harm.
И я не знаю по каким причинам.
And I don't know for what reasons.
Бог не защищает в этот момент.
God doesn't protect for that moment.
Я могу сказать за себя.
I'll tell you for myself personally.
Я буду защищать.
I will protect my family to the death. All right. We have very little time, so I think we're going to conclude on this next question. Next question is Pastor Slavik. What does it really mean to have a relationship with God? This has been text a lot. A lot of people asked, what does it really mean when you say relationship with God? How does that look? How do I know I have a relationship with God?
Well, first of all, I think we are created to have a relationship. God says, let us create a man in our own image. When Pharisees came to Jesus, they brought this question and they said, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar? And Jesus says, bring me a coin. They brought the coin. He says, whose image on the coin? Caesar's. And he says this, give Caesar what belongs to Caesar and give God what belongs to God. From the beginning, we belong to God. Now, why is it important for us to have a relationship with God? Since the humanity fell, and there is no way for us to recover without having a relationship with God. Jesus says, to your believers, those who believed that Jesus is the Son of God, he says, to the believers, know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Why is it important for us to have a relationship? Without relationship, there's no fruit. Without intimate relationship with God, we won't have a fruit in our life. You know, there was one evangelist that had multiple of people would repent at his crusade. And people come up to him and they ask this question, how many people did repent today at your altar call? And he says, I don't know, we'll see in a half a year. You know, sometimes how many people came out doesn't determine that they will have the fruit of their relationship with God. What determines our relationship with God, it's the fruit. And what was Roman preaching today, that's if we live by the Spirit, which we're making a right decision, and we live by the Spirit in relationship with God, we will have that fruit.
Wow. Anybody else want to add? Okay. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank pastors. Thank you so much. Can we have a round of applause for our pastors? There's Jerry's going to add something.
Me and Roman were talking earlier, and you know, in conclusion, and it really goes along with what Slavik says too, is that, you know, none of these questions, if you were to go back and even read some old theologians, some old commentary, most of these questions that we see today were never a question in the past. I mean, the biblical evidence that is exposed is just overwhelming. But we see in knowing this that the culture of the world today is ran by Satan. That current is strong. And we see that, listen, he wants to separate us from the truth of God's word. And he wants to get us off our guard. And he wants to show us that we have liberties and think that there's gray areas. But you know what? There's really not. And I want to encourage you. Romans 14:23, and Pastor reminded me this the other night. It says, if it's not done by faith, it's sin.
Come on.
And this is what I want to encourage you, knowing about these gray areas, about the culture of this world, that you could stand strong against it, is that, you know what? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So you need to know your word. You need to know it, you need to study it, you need to love it, you need to live it. And you know what? Then you could be invited to come up and answer these questions as you live it, because you'll know the answers as the Holy Spirit works out in your life. Amen? Amen.
Awesome. Let's stand up to our feet, everybody. Let's thank God. And I, you know, the goal, when we talked about this with the pastors before we started, the goal was not to share information. The goal was honestly to share revelation. We want God's truth to be evident in our life on a daily basis. So before we leave, let's just ask God to not allow us to leave filled with information, but truly for that to sink in as revelation in our life. God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that your word is yesterday, today, and forever the same as are you, Lord God. We thank you that your word is the strong foundation that we can stand on, God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that no matter how this world changes, you stay the same, Lord God. That your love stays the same, that your blood stays the same, Lord God. Your sacrifice on the cross stays the same and unchanged, Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, that no matter what happens around us, we have the truth in you, Lord God. We thank you so much, Jesus, that you have not only called us but chosen us, Lord God, that we have the opportunity to respond to you and say yes, Lord God. We thank you so much, God, for this wonderful privilege to gather as a body, to gather with so many friends and family, Lord God, to seek your face, to draw closer to you, Lord Jesus. And we ask you, let us leave this place changed in our hearts. Let the word speak in us, Lord God, and truly change us, Lord God. Let us, as Jerry just shared, Lord God, let us truly know your word and have that word work in us, Lord God, that we would not be the people asking these questions, but we would truly be the answer for the world. God, that we, as we stand at our jobs, as we stand in our schools, Lord God, as we are in our communities, that we would be the people that would show your face to this world, that would show your love to this world, Lord God. We bless one another, and we bless the rest of this conference. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. And actually, never mind. Please, we're going to dismiss you now. We are at 4:45. We have our evening service, our last service of conference at 7.